Amid questions on the true identity of Bamban Mayor Alice Go, the Philippine Statistics Authority says the late birth registration case of the controversial official is not isolated. Victoria Tulad returns with this report.
Bamban Tarlac Mayor Alice Go was already 19 years old when her birth was registered, according to the Philippine Statistics Authority, or PSA. Go has repeatedly said she does not know why it took so long, a statement that some senators found suspicious. According to the PSA, however, late registration of birth really happens. From 2013 to 2022, the annual average delayed birth registration was more than 972,000. Of the 111 million Filipinos in 2020, 3.7 million did not have birth certificates or were not registered.
Yung negligence ng magulang para i-report po ito sa ating mga local civil registrars, yung kanila pong access din sa civil registration. So ito yung mga nasa liblib na lugar na wala po silang way para pumunta sa bayan para mag-register.
What is more troubling is the proliferation of fake birth certificates. PSA is currently investigating about 300 local cases of this and 65 cases involving foreigners.
What we know is meron po talaga mga dokumento natin na kumbaga natatamper or nagiging fake na nasasubmit sa ating pong mga government partners or other agencies. So meron na rin po kami mga naimbestigahan na mga empleyado na involved at nakasuhan po natin. Yung iba din po ay may mga na-terminate na rin po ng mga service. So ini-ensure lang po namin na talagang kumbaga yung sistema natin ay fully protected.
In Go's case, Senator Riz Ontiveros and Sherwin Gatchalian said the mayor's father, Jiang Zonggo or Angelito Go, may have lied when he applied for a birth certificate. This after the existence of Go's mother, Amelia Leal, was put into question because the PSA could not find her birth certificate. There was also no record of Angelito and Amelia's marriage, even if the birth certificate of Go and her siblings indicated that the two got married twice. The Office of the Solicitor General is still gathering evidence on Mayor Go. It will proceed with a co-warranto if there is enough basis. A co-warranto is a legal remedy that questions the validity of a public official's appointment. According to Soljen Guevara, if Go is not a Filipino, she cannot govern. Meanwhile, according to Nationalist People's Coalition or NPC chairman and former Senate President Tito Soto, he is still awaiting the report of Tarlac Governor Susan Yap on Go. Go joined the NPC after winning as an independent candidate in the 2022 elections.
Although Congress is on break, the Senate will still continue with its hearing on the illegal pogos in Bamban Tarlac and their possible connection to Mayor Alice Go. Senators will also have a closed-door meeting or executive session with some government agencies.
In a statement, Ontiveros says their hearings are not meant to attack Filipinos of Chinese heritage. She adds that the proceedings are not a witch hunt and are not about politics, but about national security. For Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, the inquiry should center on pogos and the call to put an end to these. We are still trying to get the side of Mayor Go. Victoria Tulad, ABS-CBN News.
Well, President Marcos is now in Brunei for a two-day state visit. On the agenda, boosting economic and defense ties with the second richest country in Southeast Asia. Our very own Katrina Domingo joins us with an update. Kat, over to you.
Hi, Carmina. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. arrived here in Brunei a minute past 10 in the morning, and he is currently in a meeting with Bruneian Sultan Hassanal Bolkiah here at the Istana Nurul Iman, the official residence of the ruler of Southeast Asia's second richest country. The two Southeast Asian leaders are expected to witness the signing of cooperation deals on tourism, maritime cooperation, and food security. The president is quite confident that his visit here in Brunei will help the Philippines secure more jobs and investments. Let's listen to a portion of the president's pre-departure speech.
I am confident that our partnership with Brunei in these important sectors will further bolster our political, economic, and people-to-people ties. I look forward to securing investments that will generate more jobs, contribute to poverty alleviation, and accelerate the economic transformation of our country.
For me, Carmina, we have yet to get a copy of the agreements that the Philippines and Brunei will be signing today. But in the past few years or in the past few months, the Philippines and Brunei have been discussing possible opportunities in agriculture where the Philippines will export Japanese and sticky rice variants to Brunei between 2024 and 2025. Manila has also been working to export coconut peat, coconut oil, sweet corn, cacao, and other high-value crops, fishery, and poultry products to Brunei. That's according to the Department of Agriculture, which released an earlier statement. Now, Carmina, while Credit Suisse's 2023 Global Wealth Report cited Brunei as the 11th richest country in the world, more than half of the Sultanate's gross domestic product relies on its petroleum industry, making it the third largest oil producer in Southeast Asia and the fourth largest producer of liquefied natural gas in the world. Brunei has been seeking to diversify its economy to make it less dependent on oil, and the Philippines, particularly President Marcos Jr., is expected to make the most out of that opportunity during his first state visit here.
The death toll due to Typhoon Aghon in Quezon Province climbs to 6. Local police said 2 died in Lucena City, while the other drowned in Mauban. These are on the or make that on top of the 3 fatalities earlier reported in the province. 2 districts have already been placed under a state of calamity. Quezon's disaster management office also saying over 15,000 individuals were affected by Aghon. For the country's disaster management agency, the official death toll due to Aghon remains at 1. That figure, though, expected to increase as the agency collects more data from typhoon-hit areas. Bianca Davanau joins us with the latest. Bianca, what more can you tell us?
Hi, Carmina. Typhoon Aghon has left 1 person dead and 8 others injured, according to the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council, or NDRRMC. The NDRRMC said a 14-year-old female from Misamis Oriental was killed after a tree was toppled by Aghon's strong wind. The Office of Civil Defense, or OCD, is still validating reports of 5 other fatalities. Meanwhile, there were no missing people reported due to the typhoon. The NDRRMC noted that Aghon has affected over 36,000 people in the following regions. We have Calabarzon, Mimaropa, Bicol, Central Visayas, Eastern Visayas, and National Capital Region. Of the total, 16,000 people are staying in evacuation centers, while the remaining are staying with friends or relatives. According to the NDRRMC, the government has so far provided 3.67 million pesos worth of assistance to affected families. Carmina?
All right, Bianca, just a quick question. We just reported that there are now 6 fatalities because of Typhoon Aghon, although the NDRRMC has yet to verify that. So now the official count is just at 1. May we ask why the slow process in verification? It's taking NDRRMC quite a while to verify these deaths. Bianca?
Yes, Carmina, we've also observed that in the previous typhoons that have hit the country, that it takes really a while for the NDRRMC or the OCD to verify these data, especially when it comes to the deaths and the injuries. So far, as of 8 a.m. or as of the 8 a.m. situational report of the NDRRMC on Tuesday, only 1 person was confirmed dead due to Aghon, and the OCD and the NDRRMC are still verifying these 5 other reported fatalities.
All right, Bianca Dava there joining us live.